Today we're doing a Halloween themed craft. As you can see, here's the before that I'm unwrapping, and in the corner is a picture of the after. A fun frame of googly eyes to get you in the Halloween-y spirit. So the title of the video this week was Who is in the Trunk? Woo-hoo! And by trunk, I mean the trunk of the car, not trunk like a suitcase. I can tell you what wasn't in the trunk of the car. This framed wood sign that I got at Walmart. I think it was around $5. It was already painted white, so that's nice. But you know I'm still going to paint the sides. At least the inside bottom panel is ready to go. But who was inside the trunk of the car? There seem to have been quite a few stories about bodies being put in the trunks of cars or people shooting from the trunks of cars, but I'm not sure if you've heard of this particular crime story. This is a Canadian true crime tale, and it might just change your idea of Canadians. I myself am Canadian, but I live in the States now and I've been here for close to 10 years. I just got my citizenship this year. Woo! When I moved here, so many people were like, oh yay, you're Canadian. I love Canadians. You guys are all so nice. You must speak perfect French. You're probably so happy to be out of the cold. Oh, yada, yada, yada. Guys, there's a lot I could say about stereotypes, but let me start by saying that yes, I do love maple syrup. I'm sorry, I can't help myself. And yes, I do apologize a lot. I'm sorry, I can't help myself. No, it's not always cold in Canada. And yes, different provinces do get more snow than others. No, I did not grow up in an igloo. Yes, I learned French in school, but no, I'm not bilingual. In fact, my French kind of sucks, but I can understand quite a bit when I hear it. The English-French thing is actually really important to our story today, because this is a crime that took place in the province of Quebec, which is where the majority of the French-speaking people in Canada reside. So, when you think of Quebec, what do you think of? Maybe Paris with a maple leaf? A hockey stick wearing a beret? I've heard so many, let's say creative, things about Canadians in general since moving to the States. And to be fair, I had some ideas about the US that have proven to be pretty ridiculous too, so it does go both ways. Let me tell you really quick, not every Canadian is fluent in French, although when I grew up we all had to take some classes in school, and all of our products and marketing has both English and French on it. There are 10 provinces and 3 territories, which are basically provinces, but they're not. Just, you know what, just go with it. And only one of them has French as, I'd say, the predominant language, and that's Quebec. But there are people all across Canada who are fluent in both languages. And I would say that just because you're a Canadian, it doesn't mean that you're automatically fluent or even remotely bilingual. We do have certain Canadian words or phrases that I'm going to sprinkle throughout this video, so get ready. Anyway, what do y'all think about this guy? Ah, scary, right? That's bonhomme. Quebec City? Yeah, there's a Quebec City and Quebec the province, but Quebec City, it has this carnival every winter called the Carnaval de Quebec, and this guy, bonhomme, is the symbol of that carnival. So this creepy-ass snow monster is the first thing I think of whenever I think of Quebec. He looks like a reject from Ghostbusters, I know. But apparently he made his first appearance in 1955, so bonhomme came first. I'm sorry, Canada. My apologies to any Quebecois that may be listening to this. I'm sure you love him, but he looks weird, and I'm not afraid to poke fun at my roots. Je ne fais que taquiner. You'd think our story would be all about this blizzard booger. It's actually not. But I couldn't tell a story taking place in the province of Quebec without showing a picture of this meth head snowman. Sorry, I'm doing my home country a dirty here. This master of celebrations and king of festivities. Yeah, whatever. I learned about bonhomme in my high school French class, and let me tell you, he was nightmare fuel. He just seems like he should be in a true crime story, you know? I'm sorry, I can't help myself. I'm sorry, I'm sure he's just fine. If you love him, don't hate me. Okay, so here we go. Who is in the trunk? Well, I'll get to that, okay? Let me tell you though, this is some true crime that I think a lot of people haven't covered. This whole thing might surprise you. This is a story of Canadian terrorists. You heard that right. You guys thought the U.S. were the only ones dealing with terrorists, right? You thought we were too high on tree sugar and Tim Hortons coffee to be dealing with anything other than hockey night in Canada? Think again, people. So who am I talking about? I'm talking about the FLQ. Da fuck? Meaning, da fuck? No, the Front de Libération du Québec. The Quebec Liberation Front. Sounds scary, right? They were. When you Google them, you often see headlines like 7 years of terrorism. So the FLQ had been wreaking havoc all through the 1960s. And I swear I am not obsessed with historical crime. For some reason, it's just where my head has been at lately. What are some Halloween colors? Black and purple. That sounds good. So who were these people and why were they causing all this kerfuffle? And who did they put in the car already? Yeah, we'll get to it, I promise. The FLQ were a faction of the original separatist movement. Any Canadian nowadays knows what that means. And as long as I've been alive, there have been les separatistes talking about how Quebec should stand on its own. For those outside of Canada, I'm thinking this is probably something you haven't heard about. But maybe even for those who grew up knowing les separatistes, maybe you didn't know the origins of it. So let's go back to the 60s and I'll skim through the framework and get right into today's story. So at the beginning of the 1960s, the sense of nationalistic pride within Quebec was wavering for much of the population. The 60s were a weird time. The Vietnam War was going on, the Cuban Revolution had just ended in 1959, and there were always news reports about the IRA, the Irish Republican Army. And even in Spain, there was the ETA. When you translate it, it stood for the Basque Homeland and Freedom. All these armies were fighting for freedom and national liberation. The news stories were everywhere, and in Quebec, the stories really hit for some people who had begun to think that maybe they should be free from the rest of Canada. In 1962, the president of the Canadian National Railway made a really smart decision and announced that a French Canadian wouldn't be competent enough to be vice president of his company. Way to go, bud. I bet looking back, he isn't regretting any of his life choices. Because after he made that announcement, a not-so-secret group was created. The Réseau de Résistance pour la Libération Nationale du Québec. For those of you who either don't understand French or don't understand whatever bungled version of French I'm attempting to speak, the not-so-secret group was called Resistance Network for the National Liberation of Quebec. Get used to hearing my bad French, people. It's almost as bad as my Spanish, muchachos. So what these resistors did was basically graffiti stuff demanding the independence of Quebec. So they would spray paint Vive le Québec libre on a public monument or a building or a road sign. Ooh, scandalous. Ooh, so crafty. See what I did there? A year later, in 1963, about 30 members branched off from the graffiti guys. These 30 members had a conversation and were like, hey, spray paint is cool and everything, but like, nothing really seems to be changing. And I mean, the neighborhood looks more like the set of a Run DMC video now than it did before. And that's weird, since Run DMC doesn't exist yet. And that means we're having an existential crisis. And we don't know how to deal with this. In the meantime, our separatist dreams aren't coming true. We need to do something about this. And the best way to deal with our dreams not coming true is obviously violence. I mean, duh. This is a true crime story. What else did you think it was going to be? So these guys named themselves the Quebec Liberation Front, the Front de Libération du Québec, or the FLQ. They used pictures of this happy-looking fella in their communications. It was a whole vibe. And they weren't going to sit around playing arts and crafts with spray paints. Hey, what's wrong with arts and crafts? So they weren't just going to sit around. They were going to kick ass and take names. Really, give her. Only 3 weeks later, these guys had made up some drinks. And I'm not saying they had gone crazy with a couple Mickeys and a bunch of 2-4s and Molsons. Yeah, no. What I'm saying is they made up some Molotov cocktails and toss them at three armories of the Canadian Army in Montreal. What a freaking gong show. And if you Americans couldn't understand the Canadianisms in this last part, then I can't translate it for you because it made perfect sense to me. What really sucks is that Wilfred O'Neill, a nighttime security guard at a Canadian Armed Forces recruiting center, was killed during one of these Molotov cocktail bombings. So right off the bat, these guys ended up accidentally killing somebody. Awesome work. That's a beauty. At least the FLQ claimed responsibility right away. I'm not really sure why. Maybe out of guilt, maybe because they thought it made them look cool, I don't know. In October 1963, Gabriel Houdon, Raymond Villeneuve, Jacques Giraud, and Yves Labonté pled guilty to manslaughter in the death of Wilfred O'Neill. Their sentences range from 6 to 12 years in prison. Within the FLQ, two groups sprung up that decided, hey, we better figure out a way to get our hands on some guns and some money. Because how can we be rad revolutionaries and start our own country if we don't have any moolah or a way to shoot ourselves out of the middle of the country? Or something, I don't know. Sorry. One group called itself ALQ, which stood for Armée de Libération du Québec, the Liberation Army of Quebec. The other called itself ARQ, for Armée Révolutionnaire du Québec, the Revolutionary Army of Quebec. These names are stunningly original and daring and, might I say, breathe a new life into the notion of emancipation. Jokes! So we come round to 1964, and the ARQ decides, this is our moment, right now! They went into a gun store in Montreal because, despite what Michael Moore documentaries might tell you, there are actually gun stores and gun owners in Canada. So they go into this gun store and stole $50,000 in cash and military equipment, which is like, what, $10 American? I suck at math, sorry. During the robbery, a member of ARQ killed store employee Leslie McWilliams because apparently they were just really good at killing people whether they meant to or not. Then when the police showed up, they mistook another employee, Alfred Pinnich, and killed him. So everybody is just winning all around except, obviously, the poor employees who just turned up for work that day. Great job, everybody else. Well done. Five ARQ members were arrested and convicted. One of them got 20 years, two got life in prison, and two of them got the death penalty. When I read that, I was like, wait a second, this is Canada. Canada doesn't have the death penalty. What in the hockey puck? So I used some Google fingers, and it turns out that capital punishment ended in Canada in 1976, which was a great year for that reason, but also because it was the year that I was born. So yays for everybody, except for Leslie McWilliams and Alfred Pinnich. No yays for them being killed. That's awful. Sorry. I know you're probably like, okay, cool story, bruh, but this has nothing to do with anybody being stuffed in a trunk. To which I say, hey, don't call me bruh. I get enough of that from my son. Who told him he could stop calling me mommy and start calling me bruh anyway? And second, all this is leading up to the trunk stuff, okay? Just trust me. You need to know this, or the trunk story just won't make sense, okay? I promise. Would a Canadian lie to you? I mean, really. I grew up on maple syrup. I'm too sweet to lie. So I'm going to speed the story along a little bit now that I've set the scene. From 1963 to 1970, the FLQ basically acted like a bunch of drunk frat bros at a very violent extended frosh party. That is to say, the attitude of entitlement, rage, and general douchebaggery was extreme. They had their own newsletter called La Cogne, which meant the hatchet, later renamed to La Victoire, the victory, which included instructions on how to make bombs. Super classy. And of course, someone else was killed, a woman who I'm sure was perfectly lovely and didn't deserve what happened. That woman was named Thérèse Morin, who was a secretary at a shoe factory in Montreal. She was killed when she opened a mail bomb. I just want to state that I'm making a point to name the victims that I'm aware of. I think the victims deserve respect and privacy, and the least I can do is honor them by acknowledging them by name. Obviously, the FLQ is looking like a bunch of wingnuts to the rest of Canada by now. And I want to be clear, from my research, not every Québécois person, meaning not every French Canadian, was buying into the idea of separating from Canada. Or even if they did want to separate, they weren't on board with all these displays of violence and criminal activity. Canadians are mostly pacifists, right? But on July 24th, 1967, the cause got this big boost from Charles de Gaulle. Now, if you don't know who that is, he's this French army officer who led this Free France campaign against Nazi Germany during World War II, and honestly, explaining him could be a whole separate podcast, and I'd have to do a ton more research that I don't really want to do right now. I just know he's a big Libération guy and was really quite famous at the time. So, he's in Montreal, and he's standing on this balcony giving a speech, and he shouts, "Vive le Québec libre!" which means, "Long live free Quebec!" Can someone go back in time and tell this guy that he is not helping? Like, come on, dude, read the room. Bombs going off, banks being robbed, dynamite being stolen. What in the royal hell do you think you are doing, monsieur? I'm sorry, I mean, je regrette, mais. So in response to that, Prime Minister Pearson was like, hey now. Pearson had a message delivered to the French embassy. So you know he meant business. He probably sent some maple candy and some pussy willow stems to soften his words, because, you know, Canadians. His message said, "The people of Canada are free. Every province in Canada is free. Canadians do not need to be liberated. Indeed, many thousands of Canadians gave their lives in two world wars in the liberation of France and other European countries. You tell him, Lester Pearson! No wonder they named an airport after you." I think that message really showed him. You don't mess with Canadians, yo. We got a way with words that'll cut you. So that was in 1967. Let's fast forward 3 years to February 1970. Two men are driving a truck in Montreal and are arrested with sawed-off shotguns, which is always an excellent sign of things to come, and a communique announcing a kidnapping of this Israeli consul guy. The thing is, no Israeli consul had actually been kidnapped. Weird, right? I guess the arrest had intervened with their plans. So take that and just file it away. So the thing about the FLQ is that it had grown quite large, and it was operating with all these different cells. They had given all these cells different names, and honestly, it's really confusing and not very important to our story, so I'm not going to get into it. But it seemed like it was really organized and kind of creepy. So in 1970, there's this British diplomat who's living in Canada. James Cross had previously served in India and Malaysia, and he was now serving in Montreal. So sneaking up onto October 5th, two members of the Liberation Cell. Man, these guys were really all up in their fields when it came to naming stuff. Go ahead and kidnap this guy from his home. Because of course they do! And they do it in the most Canadian way, too. They go to his front door, and he's got a maid because he's a diplomat and a very important person. So his maid goes to the door, and these two guys are waiting very politely for her to open it. And when she does, they're like, "Oh, salut! We're here to see Monsieur Cross. We're delivery men, and we have a gift here for his birthday that just passed." So the maid is like, "Oh, how wonderful! Merci et bienvenue!" And she lets them inside. And when they come in, they pull out a revolver and a rifle, which I have to say is not very Canadian or birthday-like of them, and kidnap Cross, which is not a very good birthday gift at all. 0 out of 10 stars, do not recommend. They immediately send a communique to the authorities. I don't know why they send communiques and don't just send ransom notes like normal criminals. Maybe it's because their communiques feature this picture and most ransom notes don't. Sorry. But anyway, they send a communique with 7 demands, including $500,000, $10 American, the release of 23 FLQ so-called political prisoners, a totally original concept, way to go, really get her done, the broadcast and release of the FLQ manifesto, and safe passage to Algeria or Cuba. I found this sheet of googly eyes at Walmart too. It wasn't expensive, I think $2? This whole craft was really cheap. I'm trying to figure out where I want them. They have sticky backs, but some of the stickies were staying on the plastic sheet. The government was given 24 hours to comply, and the government was like, "Yeah, no, but we can negotiate." I want to spend a second talking about the manifesto. This manifesto basically rambled on criticizing big business, the Catholic Church, a Canadian politician named René Levesque, and another Quebecois politician named Robert Bourassa. I've never heard of a manifesto criticizing big business, the Catholic Church, or politicians before. These guys wanted to be revolutionaries, and I think they really nailed it here. So it turns out the terms of the ransom were the exact same as the terms found in the ransom note from when the police arrested those two guys earlier in the year in the truck, with the plans to kidnap the Israeli consul guy that didn't happen. At the time, the police didn't connect the dots between the two. And on the one hand, I want to scream, yeah, no, what? But on the other hand, I think we can understand to a degree why. There were so many cells to the FLQ, and they were all causing so much trouble, splintering off and causing chaos. There was no internet or anything, and I'm not sure the police departments really had a decent way of communicating with each other quickly. Hindsight, you know? So the kidnapping happens on the 5th of October. And I know what you're thinking, so when does James Cross end up in the trunk of the car already? Just hang on! Because on October 8th, that darn manifesto, it does get played on the CBC across Quebec in both English and French. For anybody that doesn't know, the CBC is the National Public Radio and Television. 2 days after the manifesto is read, October 10th, Quebec Justice Minister Jérôme Choquette says, hey, if you let Cross go, we'll give you safe passage out of Canada and make you somebody else's problem. But if you think your other demands are going to get met, well, then you must have been chomping on some stale timbits, monsieur. Okay, you said it better than that. But the FLQ took that to mean, just get the F out and we'll call it a day, okay? The Chenier cell of the FLQ made their feelings known about that proposition almost immediately by looking up the address of the Quebec Minister of Labor, Pierre Laporte, in the phone book. Excellent privacy settings way back then, I'm telling you. Laporte was playing with his nephew in the front yard of his home when they snuck up on him and kidnapped him. I feel like there should be a better word for that. They adult-napped him. No, that just sounds like they forced him to take a break and have a little night-night because he was working too hard. That sounds kind of nice, actually. They man-grabbed him. Ooh, that sounds bad on a variety of levels. They person-grabbed him. Okay, fine, they kidnapped him. C'est quoi? I'm sure his nephew is still in therapy from seeing that. Seriously. The next day, the CBC broadcasts a letter from Pierre Laporte from captivity to the Premier of Quebec, Robert Bourassa. A premier is kind of like the Canadian equivalent of governor. On October 12th, the FLQ does the only mildly intelligent thing I think they have done this far, and they lawyer up. They hire Robert Lemieux to negotiate the release of James Cross and Pierre Laporte. The government of Quebec appoints a guy named Robert Demers, because apparently every other guy in the story needs to be named Robert. Also on the 12th, Prime Minister Trudeau had sent armed troops to Quebec and Ottawa. Ottawa is where all the important government buildings are, and it's in the province next to Quebec. Anyway, Trudeau went all serious on the FLQ's ass. And I know what you're thinking here. Trudeau was prime minister then? Does this guy ever age? Like, seriously? Relax, everybody. It was Justin Trudeau's dad. The next day, Trudeau Sr. had a fairly combative interview on the CBC about all the military and the mass arrests that happened the day before. There were like 500 people arrested. Canadians are known for being peaceful and not going gonzo on the public and arresting people like that. Trudeau's response was basically like, well, seriously, bruh, what would you have done, huh? Huh? When the interviewer asks him how far Trudeau is willing to go, he responds with, just watch me. Holy stress, people! This is insane! This is Canada! Land of the moose and maple candy! Where you can get yourself a double-double on every corner. Land of this guy. Okay. So only 3 days later, on the 15th, the negotiations completely break down. I won't go into detail because this thing is getting really long, but Lemieux basically encourages this huge rally of students and separatists. And then this other politician makes this harebrained statement saying that there are more boys ready to shoot members of parliament than there are policemen. So basically, suck it up, people. The rest of Canada is watching Quebec and preparing for what looks like an insurrection. And you guys thought insurrection crap only happened in the States. So the next day, Robert Bourassa, he's the Robert who is the premier of Quebec. I'm imagining that he's just on the verge of a breakdown because I know I would be. He asked Trudeau to grant the government of Quebec emergency powers to just go cowtown crazy, apprehending and keeping people in custody. He was trying to maintain some kind of order in what was quickly becoming an extremely out of control situation. So Trudeau was all like, I can do you a solid, bruh. I see your emergency powers and I raise you a War Measures Act. This is the first and only time it's ever been used in a domestic crisis in Canada. Things were stressy. I bet everybody wished they could just pack up and drive off and get away from the situation. Maybe in a nice fancy Chevrolet Biscayne. Maybe be a snowbird for the season, like head to Florida and enjoy the weather. Except that idea won't work because in the back of the Biscayne is the body of Pierre Laporte. Boom! There you go! 7 days after his kidnapping, 1 day after the War Measures Act had been invoked, the body of Laporte was found in the back of a Chevrolet Biscayne at the Montréal-Saint-Hubert Longueuil Airport. I have no idea if I said that right. This was on October 17th. The public found out in 2010 that he was killed accidentally in a moment of panic by being choked, which I don't truly understand since choking is a physically hard thing to do, but okay. James Cross was still being held by the Liberation Cell of the FLQ. Once Laporte's body had been discovered, the Liberation Cell sent a communique, of course, saying that Cross was still alive but was being held indefinitely until their demands were met. Let's flash forward to November 6th. The police do this huge raid at the hiding place of the FLQ's Chenier cell. Three members escape, but there are mass arrests, and this guy named Bernard Lorty is charged with the kidnapping and murder of Pierre Laporte. I'm just thankful his name isn't Robert. On December 4th, 1970, James Cross is released by the FLQ Liberation Cell after lots of negotiations between lawyers. He had been held hostage for 62 days. He had lost 22 pounds, but overall he was in pretty good health otherwise. And he said his captors were pretty courteous to him overall. I mean, they were Canadians after all. His five captors, who I won't name here because despite being polite, I still think they suck, were granted safe passage to Cuba by the government of Canada after Fidel Castro gave him the okay. One of those guys was the same dude who was arrested in the truck with the papers outlining the ransom and kidnapping for the Israeli consul guy. What a douche! It took almost a month for Trudeau to decide he should withdraw all the troops from Quebec. And it wasn't until January 5th of 1971 that the military presence actually left the province. Just before the close of 1970, the three members of the Chenier cell who had escaped the raid were found hiding in a tunnel out in the sticks. Later on, they were also charged with the kidnapping and murder of Pierre Laporte. So there you go, guys, the story of the man in the trunk. Can you believe this Canadian told a story about Canada without saying a single time? We don't actually say it that much, you guys. So my friend told me I should let you know what I'm planning for the next week's video so you guys can craft along with me. I think I'm going to make some greeting cards next week, so get your stamps and inks ready. As always, thank you so much for joining me. I really hope you enjoyed this story and that you learned something new about Canadians. I really appreciate it if you hit the like button and subscribe if you haven't already. Come back next Tuesday for a brand new video. And everybody, go forth, be awesome and amazing, everybody!